India. India's artists to give up figurativism for abstract art.
When I make a, you know, start a painting on oils, I try to make it as possible, rough with lines, the charcoal, so that I could make changes and create certain forms which to me look more appealing and more original or something more unique. So I try to, sometimes difficult to say, but ultimately nothing may remain of this thing. It may be completely different, but it is just an exercise in trying to find out some things which would be which are more significant and important. I was a student of economics, MA economics from Delhi University. And every evening we were taking a round in Crown Place, just loitering away. And I saw in a board, art exhibition, in above coffee house. There was a coffee house which was the center of student life in Delhi at that time. That was the only restaurant perhaps. And I was intrigued. So we say, I just told my friend, let us go up and see what is this art exhibition. That's the first time I saw a painting. That was when my final year of MA in the university. So I was quite intrigued and I inquired and they say, yes, you can join the evening classes. They've got an evening classes. And Mr. Sailur Mukherjee is quite a well-known artist. He was teaching there in the evening. So I thought, rather than wasting my time when taking rounds of Crown Place, why shouldn't I join that? I joined that. Sarada Yukin School of Art Palace was the only school, art school in Delhi at that time. It was a private school run by some individual artists, Bengali artists, who had the place and all that, so they started it. But it was more emphasis was on Indian style of painting, like people like wash technique. Wash technique is a different sort of watercolor. When it is wet, the paper is wet, then you make some make some colors and doing. So it was similar to the old Bengal school called Nandlal Bose and Abhinandan Tagore. But Sailor Mukherjee was westernized, you know. He was influenced by French paintings and all that. He knew. At that time, nobody knew much, but Sailor Mukherjee had gone to Paris. So in some other, with some other scouts, I think he was. And then he was influenced, and he was teaching Western style painting. Western style painting like anatomy and still life. But he was very quite strict in his judgment, and he was very profound. As an artist also, he was very sensitive. Later on, I met him number of times in a bar or something, and he would go on talking and talking. But I still remember that his talk was so profound and so truthful and so much apt that I have never seen any other artist talking in that way. In fact, I wanted to be a writer from the very childhood. From the beginning, I was writing short stories when I was in college. I won some award in a magazine, college magazines of St. Stephen College. So anyhow, that way, and then they were getting published also in papers. But when that was during the college days, I became interested in painting also. But writing was continuing. Writing was there. So writing had no, there was no clash between the two. But slowly, when the painting started taking more time of mine, and so I was devoting gradually less and less on writing than on painting. I was gradually reaching a point where I thought that I would have to choose one thing or give more importance to one, either painting. But painting was becoming more, I was becoming more fascinating, and I thought as a profession. And you know, as a writer, nobody could have earned at that time one's own livelihood by just writing short stories. But by painting would sell at, you know, at least 1,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees, but short story will bring only 20 rupees. So that economic factor also was there at that time. So that also decided for good and for all. This was a very practical solution of earning your livelihood. Raza, for the first time, I was fascinated by him. So I introduced myself to him. I said, I'm a young painter, trying to be a painter, and I like your exhibition. Anyhow, he was always very supporting of the young people. Always gave lots of support. So when he was in Bombay, I had a flat, some relative had a flat. So I thought I should go to Bombay. I had more friends, and Bombay atmosphere was more lively than Delhi. So I went, and for 1 month I stayed there. Raza was working with somebody in somebody's studio, Radharam studio, that I remember, near Purusha Mehta Road, center of Bombay. So I was going there off and on. Sometimes he was spending the night there also. When Raza was living in Kalyan, this far. That was a very good month, 1 month. And I was painting in the night and the daytime we were. And I met lots of some friends. That was the time in 49, when after doing it, for 2 years I think I did some job, worked in a bank, worked in a newspaper, Hindustan Times, Hindi paper, and some other jobs. Then I told my father that, listen, I would like to go to Paris and have proper art education, which I never had in India, like going to an art college in the Ecole des Beaux-Arts and all that. So my father said that he didn't have any much money. He was a government of India officer, but he was quite nice. That he said he'll buy a ticket for the boat, which was, I think, 750 rupees at that time. 15 days in the ship, and I say all that you buy. But there was another person in French, Claude Junot. He was the cultural counselor of the French embassy in Delhi. He was very friendly with Raza and other artists. He was interested in contemporary art. He told me that, listen, you can't go to Paris just like without any money in your pocket. You must try to have some money. He was nice. He says, all right, we have got some spare fund in the government. So what I can give you is 100 rupees a month for a year. You can have that. So I got. And with this limited finance, but lot of courage, I went to Paris.
Ramkumar was very young and absolutely the first time in Paris, so he was very impressed. He was in a state of shock almost, but loved everything and was very, very impressed. He kept saying, so this is Paris, this is Paris. And in his quiet way, he was very funny. I think he was the funniest, but very shy. I think they would have been completely lost without Jean, who wanted to help them maximum. And Jean had his job, of course. So he took them and introduced them to all his friends in UNESCO, especially the most important was Philippe Soupault, Bill Farr, who all bought their paintings. They'd come and have baths at our place, eat potatoes, talk all the time, mostly about Paris and painting.
And those days, you know, having a bath also was a problem because there were no bathrooms. And so whenever we went to a place where there were bathrooms, immediately we could rush to the bathroom and have a bath. And rather than going to a public bathroom was expensive also in Paris. Those days we couldn't afford. There was a dancing school downstairs, and we were on the first floor. So on Saturday, there would be a lot of dancing going on, and some of the students will leave the class and go and dance, and then come back again. André Lhote was a very human person, very friendly. He would come to the school every day, so no question of. And then he will go from easel to easel, trying to see and tell the student, okay, what are the defects and all that. And then again, he has his theory, straight line and curve. And he said, yeah, see. And then he bring out from his pocketbook the reproductions of masters and see, trying to prove that these are straight lines and curves. So it's better to construct a painting in that manner. That way he was, but still at the same time, I think once he came to my studio, he said, there is some oriental mysticism in your painting. Yeah, that may be because he might have seen that he's a person from India. At that time, you know, I was the only Indian student in his school. So the question of, so he thought there is some oriental mysticism should be from India. That's why I think somebody told me that yes, that they expected something like Dostoevsky's novel from India. But on the other hand, what they received was Mulk Raz Anand, you know, things like that, because the shock of novelty, yeah. When I was in India, you know, I was not very active in politics, but my younger brother, who was very quite active, he was about 5 years junior to me, but and then I was friendly with his friends also. So I became interested in left politics, but it was only on surface, not very much deep. I was never a strong worker, active worker of the party. Then when I in Paris, naturally, I tried to, you know, I remember still that when I was going in a bus or somewhere, then I saw the board of Communist Party office. So I was quite fascinated. And once I got down and went inside, I said, I'm from India, and I'm also a member of the Communist Party, and I'm a painter, you see. So I think there was somebody there in the party office who told me that why shouldn't I go meet some young poets, and but they are available only in the, they are working in the papers, like Sassoir and Les Lettres Francaises. So I went there. And there I met one person who knew English slightly better. At that time I didn't know French at all. But his name was Jacques Dubois. Jacques Dubois at that time was a young poet who was working in Sassoir. And then this is the beginning. But I became more friendly because, you know, we were able to, they had a canteen which was very cheap. I was in L'Humanité's office and Sassoir, all these papers were in the same building. And their canteen was so lively and so cheap. Yeah, I was able to, we were together. And at that time, usually after war, they were talking about partisan movements and all that. The war memories were there. And I found them very, they became very friendly, some of the young poets. And I met some other people, so Aragon's wife, Elsa Trujillo, every Saturday evening they were meeting and all the writers. So I naturally I went there and I was introduced there. Aragon was the chief person at that time already. So Aragon was very friendly and he knew English also, so we were able to talk. I tell you something about Mr. Leger, School of Leger, which was at Pigalle, at that time near Blanche, Metro Blanche. I don't remember exactly the name of the school, but there were, because you know, at that time there were lots of American GIs who had got money from the American government and they wanted to study painting in Paris. So I think some the director of the school opened this school with Mr. Leger as the teacher. And lots of these American GIs, because Leger's name was very well known all over the world, so they joined the school. But Mr. Leger used to come only once in a week to give comment about paintings. Whatever the students wanted to show him, they will. So lots of American students, they did not come to the school at all. They were working at home or wherever they are, and only on Friday they will come and bring their works and put them in the easel, and Mr. Leger will comment about them. That was the procedure in the art school. But Mr. Leger's comment, I remember, that they were so apt, each and every painting. He would immediately in a moment, he'll try to find the essence of the painting and find out the weaknesses or the strong points and point them out. So those comments were very important for other people, other students also who were listening. Lots of people persuaded me that I shouldn't go back immediately. I should try to stay some more time in Paris. And all the artists were staying. Raza was staying, Akbarsha was staying, and Nerod Mazumdar, Souza was staying. So nobody was going back. But I was thinking, and somebody told me that I can get a job as a manager. There was an Indian restaurant opening in Paris. So person told me that he can get me a job as a manager in the restaurant, and I can earn some money. So, but then I decided, no, I would like to go back to India and work there, start my work there. So I came back. In fact, I had to borrow money for my ticket from the embassy. But I think that was a good decision on my part, because then I was able to feel more at home and feel the real the problems of art to some extent, or what I faced. There were again, Mr. Juno was still here. He said, don't bother and don't take up any job. If you take, once you take up a job, then you don't have time to do painting, and that will be, so we'll try to help you. So, you know, like for example, on Sunday morning, he will organize, give a party to his diplomatic people and put up, you know, 8 or 10 paintings of mine on the walls and try to proceed. At that time, at once upon a time, there was not a single man, French man in the French embassy who did not have my painting. Everybody had a painting in their homes. So, like that, you know, and one painting, if you said one painting, you could, we were living again with our father and the family, so we didn't have any expenditure of paying rent of the house and or food. So that way we were able to survive. In the beginning, I think everybody starts with a figurative painting or landscape, that way, realistic sort of landscape. And I started doing figurative painting. Once I remember that Mr. Rossellini, when he came and he saw my painting, he said that reminded him of Kafka's stories. They were figurative painting, but it's not like Hussein's figurative paintings, you know. Hussein's was based on Indian themes and all that. But mine were more of the urban predicament. It was influenced by socialist realism. I was reaching a point when I thought that I'm a little bit repeating myself. The figures are the same. When you start drawing, it comes automatically in a natural way, making a figure, composition of that. So slowly I was trying to change. In fact, there were a couple of paintings. When 1958, I went to, I was staying in Paris, sharing an apartment with Raza. So I stayed for 6 months and worked there. There we made the figures were very different from what I was doing, the socialism. There were little bit shades of distortion and abstraction in those figures. Those figures was there, but still they were not the same as they were in socialism. So gradually the change was coming. And trip to Varanasi put an end to the whole thing. And then on my return, I attended Venice Biennale. Biennale, there were lots of these non-figurative artists, and I was quite impressed. Then I went to Greece, and Greece was again gray, white and black sort of landscape, which was, and when I came to India, so I was almost a little bit of not realistic, but slightly different. So in 1961, we became friendly with Mr. Shilpat Rai, who was the son of Premchand, you know, very old Hindi writer. And he was living in Allahabad, but he had a house in Banaras. I suggested to Hussein that let us go to Banaras and do some, with the idea of sketching Banaras. Banaras we had not been to, I had also not seen. I had heard about Banaras, but never went there. So we went, we three of us, he with his house in Gadulia, and I and Hussein, we went there. And Mr. Hussein said, oh, next morning, he says, now we'll go in different directions. You go to, see, Banaras is quite big. You go on your own, I go on my own, and we meet in the evening and see, exchange notes, what we made, and that is what we did.
We used to go the whole day, move around on the ghat in the night, because Ramkumar takes time. You know, everyone has his own pace come in working. But I just immediately started doing it. In the night, whatever I've seen, I used to scribble on the paper at the wall, and that scribbling stuff. So Ramkumar was become so irritated. Please stop this nonsense. So I see he couldn't sleep because of my making noise. So I stayed there only 15 days. And I left. I said, I think now you take care of Banas. Because in 15 days, what I have imbibed is enough for me another for 10 years.
I think the most important thing is to find your own self. If you can discover your own self, then I think you have achieved it quite a little. You don't have to go again outside. That's all inside you. I was totally in the tradition of being a part of the Indian family, a big Indian family, and family relationships, your brothers and sisters and these aunts and aunts. So all these things were so deeply engrossed that you didn't have to find out the Indianness. Indianness was there. So you don't have to go and out to try to find out outside that what is Indian there. So I think, you know, and I thought spiritualism, that the same way as the part of the Indian tradition, spiritualism was there, which was not something different that we have to find out. I thought that the painting itself is so spiritual an act that you don't have to go outside to find out something more. Painting itself, because after all, see this, what is there is nothing but spiritualism in this painting. It's not. Of course, now I don't have human figures or landscapes, does it? But then, I want to make a part of painting as a part of spiritualism experience.
Oh.